Good afternoon, and welcome to our Ash Wednesday observance for today. If you notice in your bulletin, we have a special liturgy that begins on page 251 after the opening hymn. Also, when it comes to the hymns today, we will only sing the first two verses of each hymn. So we're not going to try with this group to sing four or five verses. So only the first two verses of each hymn, of which the first hymn is O Lord Throughout These 40 Days, hymn number 319 in the back of your worship book. So I invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stand as we begin our worship with O Lord Throughout These 40 Days, verses 1 and 2.
Smith will be doing the reading.
The first reading is from Joel. Blow the trumpet in Zion, sound the alarm on my holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming, it is near. A day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and thick darkness. Like blackness spread upon the mountains, a great and powerful army comes. Their light has never been from old, nor will it be again after them in ages to come. Yet even now, says the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting, with weeping, and with mourning. Rend your hearts and not your clothing. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love, and relents from punishing. Who knows whether he will not turn and relent and leave a blessing behind him? A grain offering and a drink offering for the Lord your God. Blow the trumpet in Zion, sanctify and fast. Call a solemn assembly, gather the people. Sanctify the congregation, assemble the aged, gather the children, even infants at the breast. Let the bridegroom leave his room and the bride her canopy. Between the vestibule and the altar, let the priests, the ministers of the Lord, weep. Let them say, spare your people, O Lord, and do not make your heritage a mockery, a byword among the nations. Why should it be said among the peoples, where is their God? The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
behalf of Christ to be reconciled to God. For our sake he made him to be sin, who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. As we work together with him, we urge you also not to accept the grace of God in vain. For he says, at an acceptable time I have listened to you, and on a day of salvation I have helped you. See, now is the acceptable time. See, now is the day of salvation. We are putting no obstacle in anyone's way, so that no fault may be found with our ministry. But as servants of God, we have commended ourselves in every way through great endurance, in afflictions, hardships, calamities, beatings, imprisonments, riots, labors, sleepless nights, hunger, by purity, knowledge, patience, kindness, holiness of spirit, genuine love, truthful speech, and the power of God. With the weapons of righteousness for the right hand and for the left, in honor and dishonor, in ill repute and good repute. We are treated as impostors and yet are true, as unknown and yet are well known, as dying, and see we are alive, as punished and yet not killed, as sorrowful yet always rejoicing, as poor, making many rich, as having nothing and yet possessing everything. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
This time you may take out your sermon, or actually these Wednesdays will be more like lectures than true sermons, as we look at these important words of the Christian faith. In October, we will celebrate the 500th anniversary of the Reformation. And in so doing, it is important that we understand what some of the most important words in regards to the Reformation were. And so we begin that study today. So grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. In a frontier town, a horse suddenly bolted and began tearing down the street, pulling behind it a wagon with a little boy inside. A young man, seeing the predicament, immediately with risk of danger to himself, took off after the wagon and the horse, and eventually caught up with it and was able to make the horse come to a stop and save the little boy from any harm. Well, unfortunately, that little boy grew up into a life of loss. Became a famous bandit or outlaw who terrorized people. One day he was finally captured and he was brought forth before a judge and for sentencing. And as he looked at the judge, he recognized him as the man who had saved him so many years before. And so he began to plead with the judge on that experience that he had saved his life, so he thought the judge might be merciful to him and not give him a harsh sentence. But the words from the bench silenced his pleading when the judge said, quote, "Young man, then I was your savior. Today I am your judge, and I must sentence you to be hanged." One day, Jesus will return. And he will say to rebellious sinners, "During that long day of grace, I was a savior, and I would have forgiven you. But today, I am your judge." Grace. This word could be easily described as the foundation of the Christian faith. For without grace, Christianity is just another religion. But because of Christianity is a faith that is different. To define it simply, grace is God's love for us, love we don't deserve. The gospel, the good news, is that we cannot earn God's love, we can only receive it. The story of human sin is the story of our rebellion against God. We place ourselves first before God. That's what sin is all about. Us placing our ideas, our thoughts, our wants, all our desires, our passions before what God has told us. Of course, the first thing is putting something else first before God. When God tells us He is to be first. We believe we know more than God when we have developed this rebellious attitude. We believe that we can outsmart God. We believe that we can take His gifts and use them against Him in order that we might control things. Think back to Adam and Eve. The devil came along and tempted them. And what happened? They started thinking, yeah, that would really be cool to be as smart as God. And then we could do things we wanted to do. And so they gave in. The Tower of Babel. The arrogance of those people who thought they could build a tower up to heaven and kick God out of His own heaven and then rule the world the way they wanted to rule it. Or when you study the historical books and the prophetic books of the Old Testament, you see the United Kingdom of Israel and then the divided kingdom, divided into Israel in the north and Judah in the south. You see them go along following God, being God's covenant people, and then suddenly when things start really going well, they start thinking, well, we don't have to listen to God anymore. Look at what our neighbors are doing. Look at the gods they're worshiping. Look at the type of things they're doing that we're not allowed to do. And so they would turn their back on God and start worshiping these pagan gods until suddenly an enemy appeared on their borders. And then they would go high hailing them back to God and wanting him to take their chestnuts out of the fire. But it was too late. And so sin is rebellion against God and his will. In spite of this rebellion, which any world leader would crush the people that exhibited this type of behavior, God has not abandoned us. God has taken the initiative, and through the life, death, resurrection, and ascension of our Lord Jesus Christ, has restored our relationship with him. We say grace is a gift because it is ours simply as a result of God's choice to act gracefully toward us. One thing we must never forget as Christians is that sometimes this seems to become blurred, and you've heard me talk about this many times. So we must always remember it is God who has taken the initiative. It is God who began the process of salvation. We had nothing to do with it. It is not us reaching up to God, it is God reaching down to us out of his love. And so he took this initiative through Jesus Christ. In every way, God is for us. That is grace. I challenge you to study the religions of the world and see how many religions the God that is portrayed in those other religions seems to be a God who's against his people, not for them. It's a God who makes salvation so difficult. There's so many rules and regulations. And break just one of them, and your whole life is ruined because you have to start all over. But our God is for us. That is what grace is all about. This is what St. Paul says in our text. For by grace you have been saved through faith. For by grace, undeserved love, for by this undeserved love, you have been saved. We have been rescued from sin, death, and the power of the devil and God's wrath, all because of faith in what Jesus Christ has done. There is no easier way of salvation in the world. There's no world religion that is any easier or simpler than what God has given us through Jesus Christ. By God's love for us, which we do not deserve, we are saved, rescued, to be his and live under him in his kingdom. And before we can boast, St. Paul reminds us in our text, and this is not your own doing, it is the gift of God. Again, we have nothing to do with salvation. And this is where it gets dangerous when people start talking about being born again or finding Jesus or how saved they are, because that seems to turn the emphasis from Jesus and God to the person. We have nothing to brag about. We have nothing to boast about. We haven't done a thing. It was all begun and initiated by God through Jesus Christ. And so, we have no power to change God's action. We have no right to change his action. We have no power to dilute it. We have no power to add to it, as a medieval church tried to do. And we have no power to erase it. God's plan of salvation is permanent. And it is how he reconciles the world to himself. This is how God deals with us, saving us the burden of trying to earn salvation, to earn our way into heaven by observing all kinds of rules, rituals, and regulations. So what does this all mean? What does it mean for us as followers of Jesus Christ in the 21st century? Well, first of all, God's lavish grace is not intended simply to excuse our sin. Grace does not mean we go out and sin as much as possible. That is a mistaken interpretation of grace. Instead, what grace does is that through that grace, God actually remakes us into a new creation, into a new person. If you would go back to confirmation class and you would read the modern confirmation material. They always talk about the new Adam. Through faith in Christ, we become the new Adam. Baptism washes the old Adam away that dominates us, and we become this new Adam, this child of Jesus Christ. This person guided by the Holy Spirit. This person who listens to Jesus and his will. And so, we are this new creation who, with the daily help of the Holy Spirit, tries to live their life putting God first and living life as he intends us to live and by following his word. Now, understand, we are not obligated to receive God's gift of grace. We can refuse it. And there are people who will refuse it. God does not drag anyone kicking and screaming into heaven if they don't want to go. That's his choice. If they want to give up this free gift to be enslaved to a form of worship that causes you to have to try to earn everything and put all these burdens on your back, you have that free choice. It's free will. And so you're not obligated. Why would you turn down God's free gift of grace? God is love, and it is God's nature to love us regardless of our response. So in other words, we can ignore God, but he doesn't ignore us. We can move away from God, but he doesn't move away from us. Remember, Jesus tells us, I believe it's in the Gospel of Luke, that he is standing and knocking on the door, continually knocking, waiting for us to open the door and let him into our heart. See, Jesus never gives up. God, through Jesus, never gives up trying to get us to accept his free gift of grace. And he even is full of so much love for us that he will even accept us on our deathbed. We can live a whole life of rebellion, and yet before we die, we accept that free gift of grace, and God grants it to us. So because of this, because God responds always to love us, because he doesn't ignore us when we ignore him, because he doesn't move away from us when we move away from him, he enables us then to do good works, not to earn salvation, but as a response to that love, he has already shown us. Good works are the fruit of our relationship with God based on grace. They're just a natural response to all this love we have been shown. And so God's grace is important because it begins the whole relationship. And there are a number of interesting things that grace does for us. And that we are granted because of God's grace. The first is Romans 5, verses 1 and 2. For here we read, therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. So the first thing we see grace has done for us is it justifies us. That means it enables us to be declared righteous, that we are able to face God, that we are able to stand in the presence of God, not as a sinner worthy of condemnation, but as a child of the Heavenly Father and heir to the kingdom. And we have this grace that gives us peace with God. That means to be no longer a subject to God's wrath. It means to now be separated from the things of the world, joined to the things of God and his kingdom. And then in verse 2 it says, through him we have also obtained access by faith into his grace, in which we stand and we rejoice in hope to the glory of God. So now, because of grace, we have access to God. Sin keeps us from having access to God. Sin keeps us from being able to stand in the presence of God. But through grace and faith, we are able to be ushered into the presence of God. This has the imagery of the Roman Empire and trying to stand before Caesar. If you were not a friend of Caesar's, you could not be ushered into his presence. You had to have some kind of connection or some kind of person who would stand up for you so that you could be in the presence of Caesar. For us, that's Jesus Christ, who intercedes for us so that we may stand before God. So that we have access to God, so that we have access to the kingdom. So that is one of the benefits of grace. A second benefit, in 2 Corinthians 5:17-19, we read, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation." That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting us to us the message of reconciliation. So here grace makes us a new creation, this new child of God. It enables us to be reconciled to God through Jesus Christ. It enables us to be reconciled to each other through our faith in Jesus Christ. And this is how the world is reconciled to God, through Jesus Christ. Then, in 2 Thessalonians 2:16-17, we read, "Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and gave us eternal comfort and good hope through grace, comfort your hearts and establish them in every good work and work." So here grace gives us love, eternal comfort, and a good hope. All this comes from grace. If we were trying to earn salvation, we would not have that comfort, we would not have that love of God, we would not feel it, we would not have that good hope. But because of grace, we do. And then the last example, 2 Timothy 4:8, we read, "Henceforth, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have loved his appearing." So by grace, we are given the crown of righteousness. Not a crown that we have earned, not a crown that we could earn, but again, a gift through that grace of God. As brothers and sisters in faith in Jesus Christ, we should understand that grace is a force. It's like a tailwind that pushes us toward the will of God. A mighty force that brings sinners to be the children of the Heavenly Father. In the church, any church in England, there lies the tomb of John Newton. On his tombstone contains these words, which he himself wrote out and asked to be chiseled on his tombstone at his death. It reads, quote, "John Newton, once an infidel and libertine, a servant of slavery in Africa, was by the rich mercy of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ preserved, restored, pardoned, and appointed to preach the faith he had long labored to destroy." Many of you will recognize John Newton. He converted to the Christian faith. He became a priest in the Church of England, or the Anglican Church as it is known. And he went on to write one of Christianity's most beloved hymns, most sung, and most reinterpreted and rearranged century by century, "Amazing Grace." Amazing Grace. Summed up his relationship with God. How he had been this libertine and infidel, a slave owner and slave, seller of slaves, a man who profaned the Christian faith through grace, through that amazing grace. He became not just a Christian, but a priest and popular preacher in the Church of England. And then the writer of this most beloved hymn, whose first verse, I'm sure you know, "Amazing grace, how sweet the sound, that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm..." this is why grace is one of the most important words in the Christian faith. Amen. The peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. If you will look at your sermon notes for a moment, so that you will have the correct answers, because as I say, these words are so important to our belief. Question one, the answer is foundation. Grace can be easily described as a foundation of the Christian faith. Two, the simple definition of grace is God's love for us, love we don't deserve. Three, the good news is that we cannot earn God's love, we can only receive it. Four, in every way God is for us, this is grace. Five, through God's love for us, we are rescued from sin, the devil, and God's wrath. Six, God's lavish grace is not intended simply to excuse our sin. Seven, we can ignore him, but he doesn't ignore us. Eight, Romans 5:12 tells us that because of God's grace, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, and we obtain access to God. 2 Corinthians, grace makes us a new creation, and we are reconciled to God through Jesus Christ's actions, and the world is reconciled to God as well. 2 Thessalonians, grace gives us love and eternal comfort and good hope. 11, 2 Timothy, we receive a crown of righteousness. 12, grace is a force. It is like a tailwind that pushes us toward the will of God. 13, the author of amazing grace is John Newton, who after a life as an infidel and libertine became a convert to the Christian faith and a priest in the Church of England, or Anglican Church. The first verse of Amazing Grace says, "Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see." Let us now sing the first two verses of "Alas, I Did My Savior Bleed," hymn number 337, in the back of your worship.
Self-examination
giving and works of love. Strengthened by the gifts of word and sacrament, let us continue our journey through these 40 days to the great 3 days of Jesus' death and resurrection. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most holy and merciful God, we confess to you and to one another and before the whole company of heaven that we have sinned by our fault, by our own fault, by our own most grievous fault, in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart and mind and strength. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We have not forgiven others as we have been forgiven. We have shut our ears to your call to serve as Christ served us. We have not been true to the mind of Christ. We have grieved your Holy Spirit.
Have mercy on us, O God.
Our past unfaithfulness, the pride, envy, hypocrisy, and apathy that have infected our lives, we confess to you.
Have mercy on us, O God.
Our self-indulgent appetites and ways, and our exploitation of other people, we confess to you.
Have mercy on us, O God.
Our negligence in prayer and worship, and our failure to share the faith that is in us, we confess to you.
Have mercy on us, O God.
Our neglect of human need and suffering, and our indifference to injustice and cruelty, we confess to you.
Have mercy on us, O God.
Our false judgments and our uncharitable thoughts toward our neighbors, and our prejudice and contempt towards those who differ from us, we confess to you.
Have mercy on us, O God.
Our waste and pollution of your creation, and our lack of concern for those who come after us, we confess to you.
Have mercy on us, O God.
Restore us, O God, and let your anger depart from us.
Hear us, O God, for your mercy is great.
Almighty God, you've created us out of the dust of the earth. May these ashes be a sign of our mortality and penitence, reminding us that only by the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ are we given eternal life. Through the same, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Those who desire the imposition of ashes, may now come. Remember that you're dust and the dust you share. Accomplish in us, O God, the work of your salvation, that we may show forth your glory in the world. By the cross and passion of your Son, our Savior, Bring us with all your saints to the joy of his resurrection. Almighty God, have mercy on us. Forgive us all our sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen us in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us in eternal life. Amen. The Lent journey leads us to repentance and new life. Let us turn our hearts to God, who is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. Our response is, Lord, have mercy. Let us pray for the whole church, that strengthened by the disciplines of Lent, we turn from sin to find joy and abundant new life and forgiveness. We pray, Lord, have mercy. Let us pray for the nations of the world, that leaders seek peace and justice for all people, only desires for personal power and status. We pray, Lord, have mercy. Let us pray for our sisters and brothers in need, that God would give healing and God's people would respond with mercy and compassion towards others. We pray, Lord, have mercy. Let us pray for those who are preparing for baptism, that they experience God's abundant grace in this season of enlightenment and renewal. We pray, Lord, have mercy. Let us give thanks for the witness of the faithful departed, who encourage us until the day we join the great cloud of witnesses. We pray, Lord, have mercy. Merciful and gracious God, hear our prayers, restoring us to the joy of your salvation, and uphold us with your Holy Spirit, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Those who came in that difficulty, please stay. Let us pray. God of all creation, all you have made is good, and your love endures forever. You bring forth bread from the earth and fruit from the vine. Nourish us with these gifts, that we may be for the world signs of your gracious presence. In Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. St. John practices an open communion. For all those who are baptized and believe in Jesus Christ as a personal Lord and Savior, we believe his body and blood are fully present as we gather at his table. In our communion age and our own individual congregation, we invite and encourage you to come forward with us this day as we gather to take a vote, continue our service with the Great Thanksgiving on page 152 in the front of your worship. The Lord be with you.
Thank you.
Body of our Lord Jesus Christ and his precious blood, strengthen and preserve your true faith until life eternal.
Amen.
Let us pray. O God, we give you thanks that you have set before us this feast, the body and blood of your Son. By your Spirit, strengthen us to serve all in need and to give ourselves away as bread for the hungry, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
Before I announce the final hymn, just a reminder that each Wednesday we will have worship down in the chapel at 2 o'clock. For those of you who wish to continue with this study on the important words of our faith, and then of course starting next week at 5 o'clock we'll have the late supper, with the evening worship service beginning at 6:30. The afternoon service, of course, Greg will not be here for those that will not have music, but ask that you would park in the Wittenberg parking lot and come in that way so that we're not worried about both ends of the church being open. So again, that will be each Wednesday during Lent. So let us now conclude our observance with Just As I Am Without One Plea, hymn number 592, verses 1 and 2, hymn number 592.
This was our Ash Wednesday service, the 2 o'clock in the afternoon service. There will be a 6:30 service this evening, starting next Wednesday. Our Lenten services will be at 2 in the chapel and 6:30 in the sanctuary, with a light supper beginning at 5 o'clock until 6:15 every Wednesday.